Welcome to all brothers and sisters. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve you all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the good intention.
Recording in progress.
The good intention of receiving the knowledge of the deen, inshallah. And make this class for all of us seeking the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب, my dear brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah that we finish already, mashallah, the introduction, and we talk about the biography of the author, may Allah Azza wa Jalla have mercy on him, and also we started the introduction for the science of hadith. Today, inshallah, we'll start with the first hadith. But first of all, please allow me to extend my thanks and appreciation for our team members. May Allah Azza wa Jalla reward them for their help and their support. Without their help, after the help of Allah Azza wa Jalla, we may not achieve this good class. All of you know that Sister Iman Reyes, mashallah, she's taking care of this class, and also Sister Safiya, may Allah Azza wa Jalla reward her. She is the one who helped us in preparing the handout and also preparing the PowerPoint for the presentation. Sister Sarah Jones, may Allah Azza wa Jalla reward her. She is taking the attendance. And don't forget also Sister Abir Hassan, also she is our public relation at the GDC, may Allah reward them. And there are more, mashallah, sisters who are involved in helping us. May Allah Azza wa Jalla reward them all. Jazakum Allah khair jami'an. We'll start, inshallah, with the presentation, and then, inshallah, any question will be at the end of the class. I know that you already sent some questions in the group, and Sister Iman, may Allah reward her, she collected all this. And I arrange with her to, she will read all these questions at the end of the class, and we'll answer it, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khayran wa barakallahu feekum. So let's start with our today class. Bismillah. Let me share first with you the, first of all, share this screen. Sharing screen. Do you see the screen, Sister Iman? Is it clear?
Yes, it's clear.
Good. Good. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. طيب, the first hadith that we are going to study today, it is the hadith of Umar radiallahu anhu. أمير المؤمنين أبي حفص عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال رسول الله سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته إلى دنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. Now this hadith, as you see it, and I'm sure that you check in the book that you have, it's talk about niyat, or about what we call it intention. So the messenger, this was reported by or narrated by Umar radiallahu an, the second khalif, and we'll talk about his biography, inshallah, later on. The hadith start by saying actions are judged by motives, by niyyah. So this hadith was well known by hadith al-niyyat, hadith which talk about the niyyah. And so each one, man or woman will have whatever he intended. I mean, depends the action, it will be accepted and will be correct only based on the intention. That means this intention will make this action accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal if it is for Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. It is correct also if it is was in the right way. So inshallah we'll come to more detail about the explanation of the hadith. But this is the first hadith which Imam An-Nawawi started his book with. This hadith, it is very one of the most important and well-known hadith in Islam. So some of the ulama, they say that this hadith considered to represent as half of the religion. Now what does it mean, half of the religion? Because we know, my dear brothers and sisters, in Islam we have two sides, iman wa amalun salih. This is why the Quran always repeat ya ayyuhal, about when he talk about alladhina aman, he said alladhina amanu wa amilus salihat. Alladhina amanu wa amilus salih, those who believe and they do good acts or righteousness. So this is two parts, the intention which represented by iman, by belief, which is in the heart, and action which could be done either by limbs, that's mean by hands, by, you know, anything, members of the body, or by tongue. So it is either saying or action. This is a'mal. There are also a'mal which we could be classified are invisible or invisible. That's mean hidden, which is a'mal al-qulub. They call it a'mal al-qulub, the action of the hearts. Like, for example, fearing Allah, loving Allah. This is in the heart. And action which is outward, that's mean we are doing, like salah, siyam, zakah, and others. So this hadith represent, why they say it represent half? Because the other one half is what? Sincerity to Allah. And this is the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other half is the action. This is why they call it represent half of the religion. Others, like Imam al-Shafi'i or Imam Ahmad, they say this could be considered as one of third of the religion. This, if it's compared to, because there are three very important hadith which consider what was considered by which were considered by ulama as the most important ahadith, comprehensive ahadith. This hadith al-Niyyah, which the one that we are studying, hadith al-Bid'ah, which was reported by, narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha, who said man amila amalan laysa alayhi amra fahuwa rad, that's mean any action that was invited in the religion will be rejected. وحديث النعمان بن بشير who said الحلال بين والحرام بين. Halal is clear and visible, and also haram is clear and visible. This three hadith considered by the ulama are like the cornerstones for the whole knowledge of Islam. This is some. Others, they consider it one of fourth main hadith. They added to what we mentioned another hadith which talk about qadr. The hadith that said, you know, you will be created in the womb of your mother till the end of the hadith. So it's here include the qadr. So the qadr, following the rules of halal and haram, and rejecting any bid'ah. These are four important signs that we should look at it when we look at the, in general, at the religion. This is why the ulama, when they say that represent, that's mean, you know, it will teach you or included in this very short hadith. Let me just move this because it's a bit. Okay, bismillah. Because of the importance of this hadith, my dear brothers and sisters, you will find this hadith come at the beginning of many of the books of the ulama. That means they start their book by mentioning this hadith. Why? Because they want to turn, first of all, to remind themselves and to remind the readers that it's very important at the beginning of any action to correct the intention. And this is what I remind myself and also remind you, my dear brothers and sisters in this class, that we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make our gathering in this class, studying this book, is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to inquire and to increase our Islamic knowledge. If we do this, then our class, our time, whatever we say, whatever we hear, inshallah, by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, if it was accepted, inshallah, this is great good deeds, because as we said before, seeking knowledge is one of the important action of ibadah in Islam. Here I want to mention, you remember we talked last week about the what we call it, the takhrij and different chain of narrators. This hadith, even it is very important and it was accepted by all ulama, it was reported by almost by all the collector of the hadith. That's mean al-Imam al-Bukhari wa Muslim wa al-Tirmidhi wa al-Nasa'i والإمام أحمد والبيهقي وأبو داود, all of them they reported this hadith. But the strange thing, this hadith known that it is hadith غريب, it's strange, and this one a good example of the hadith of أحد. You remember we talked before that about hadith الأحد والمتواتر. أحد, that means single reporter. And it is interesting, this is why I put this chart to show you how, what does it mean by hadith al-ahad. Look at here, for example, if we come to al-Imam al-Bukhari, Imam Bukhari took this hadith from al-Humayd, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, and Abdullah ibn Zubayr took it from Sufyan, and after Sufyan he took it from Yahya ibn Sa'id, and Yahya ibn Sa'id took this hadith from Muhammad ibn Ibrahim, and Muhammad ibn Ibrahim took from Al-Qama al-Laythi, who heard it from Umar radiallahu anhu. Look at this chain of narrators. You notice that I put this in red, I hope it's clear, to show you that every collector of the hadith, like Al-Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Abu Dawood, they took it from different people. But all of them, they come together, they took it from Yahya ibn Sa'id. So this hadith, it was reported only by Umar at the generation, the Sahaba generation. And then only by Alqama al-Laythi. And then Alqama transmitted, and the one who took it from Alqama, Muhammad ibn Ibrahim. So we have about four generations of reporter or narrator of the hadith, it is the same chain. And then after the fourth one, which is Yahya ibn Sa'id, all the different people, they took it and learned from him and they transmitted. So it's become more, not ahad, it stopped at the stage of Yahya ibn Sa'id. Now it's become mutawatir because many people, they took this hadith. So this is just one example to show you a hadith al-ahad. And inshallah, all this detail we'll send it to you in the hands out that we prepare for you, inshallah. Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu an, I'm just going very fast about this because, as I said, inshallah, we'll provide you with full information in the hand out that you will get it. Umar ibn al-Khattab, all of us know him. He's the second khalif. He is the second man. The importance in the history of Islam after Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, among the Sahaba. He was always with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with Abu Bakr. This is why It was mentioned that the Sahaba, when he was dying, they told him, Ali radiallahu anhu, he was telling Umar, I always hear the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talking about, I go with Abu Bakr wa Umar. You know, I sit with Abu Bakr wa Umar. Always mention Abu Bakr wa Umar. So we know all that Umar radiallahu anhu, he's one of the greatest individual in the, not only in the Islamic history, but in the history of humanity. His nickname is Abu Hafs. Now, some people, they think that he was called Abu Hafs because of his daughter, Hafsa. But this is not correct. Why he was called Abu Hafs? You know what does it mean, Abu Hafs? Abu Hafs, among the Arabs, is the nickname of the lion. The nickname of the lion, called Abu Hafs. You know, the lion have many names. You know, the lion, because it is a symbol of strength and courage, and the Arab like it, so they give it many names, more than 100 names for the lion in the Arabic language. See, like Al-Asad, Al-Layth, Qaswara, Haydara. So Abu Hafs is, it's the nickname of the lion, and it was the nickname of Umar radiallahu an. Same like Haydara, you know, this is one of the titles of Umar radiallahu of Ali radiallahu an, and Haydara is one of the name of the lion also. Al Faruq, this is very special nickname for Umar radiallahu an, or label he was giving this title, because he was very strong in distinguishing between the truth and the false. He was born 13 years after the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We know that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in Aam al-Fil, and Umar radiallahu anhu was born 13 years later. You know, as you see, he was, mashallah, very good muscle. He was tall, solid. He was very strong. When he walk, he walk quickly. When he speak loudly and clearly. He was one of those who had learned to read. Why this mention? Because it was very seldom among the Arabs that there are people who know how to read or write. So he was among these few in the Arab community at that time who have the knowledge of reading and writing. He said, after he came to Islam and taste the you know, the sweet of faith, and compare it to what he was before Islam, he said this very nice statement, wise one, word of wisdom, that he said, the bonds of Islam will be undone one by one when there will be a generation brought up in Islam who don't know what ignorance is. And this is very important to understand, you know. People will not, any person will not appreciate the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the hidayah, the guidance, unless, you know, what does it mean if he doesn't have this? And this is why, you know, many times, you know, we find that people who converted to Islam, mashallah, they call them a new Muslim or revert to Islam, maybe they have more strong faith, deep faith. They are very, subhanAllah, devoted and sincere, maybe more than many people who born as Muslim. Why? Because these people, they understand what does it mean to be Muslim. Because they taste the ignorance before they come to Islam. They know what does it mean. But, you know, our children who grow as a Muslim and they live in this ni'mah, they may not appreciate the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of guidance that they have. And this is always, you know, if the person, if he, you know, accustomed to a certain situation, he may not think about the value of this. Like a rich child, when he born in a rich family, he doesn't, you know, maybe appreciate the gift of money or wealth that his family has, till he become, you know, broken, or he may lose all this. A person who is in a place which is safety and secure, He may not appreciate the ni'mah of security, alhamdulillah, and safety like in this country, alhamdulillah, unless he relies and live in an area or a place where there's no security. So it is almost the same in all situation. So from this we know that, you know, what does it mean, the word of Umar radiallahu an, when he mentioned this. Now, the next one, his story when he converted to Islam is very interesting, because when he started, he want to go and this is what he thought, that he will assassinate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In his way, he met someone who told him, before you do this, go and correct and check your family and your sister. And when then he went to his the house of his sister, and this story, I'm not going to go all the details, inshallah, will come to you in the handout that we will send. But the point is, his conversion to Islam was really significant addition to the standing of Islam. Muslim, they felt more strong after Umar radiallahu anhu became Muslim. Why? Because from that time, after he embraced Islam, the Muslims were able to go and pray in the Haram, in the Masjid, in the front of the Kaaba. Because Umar radiallahu anhu on one side and Hamza radiallahu anhu on the other side, they go, and the people of Quraysh, they afraid of these two men. They are very strong, very courageous. This is why when he come to Islam, it was really was very significant. When he migrate to Medina, we know that all of the Sahaba, almost, when they migrated secretly. Only Umar, the only one who immigrated openly. You know, when he decided to migrate to Medina, to hijra to Medina, he didn't hide himself, or he, you know, moved secretly. He went to the people of Quraysh in the Haram. He went to make tawaf and he pray, and then he go to them, all their circle of gatherings, and told them, I am leaving, I am immigrating. Anyone who want his children to be orphaned, or his wife to be the widow, or his mother lost him, let him follow me. And none of them was, you know, follow him for sure, because he was, as we said, courageous person, and they scared him. Umar radiallahu anhu, one of the noble traits of Umar radiallahu anhu, that he mentioned, or he said many ideas or opinions to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or suggestion, and subhanallah, Allah azza wa jalla confirm the wisdom of what Umar suggested. Like, for example, at the captive of Badr, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, of the view that they may, for, you know, just release them or free them, or maybe take ransom from them. But Umar radiallahu anhu said they should be killed. And this is what Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed in the Quran. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive whatever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. Another thing is praying in the Maqam Ibrahim. He said, O Prophet of Allah, why shouldn't pray at the Maqam Ibrahim? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, وَاتَّخِذُ مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى. Also, Umar radiallahu anhu suggested to the Prophet alayhi wa sallam that he asked his wife to put hijab, because he said different people, they enter your home. They are good, some are good, some are not. So, and then Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed so ayat al-hijab in Surah Al-Ahzab. Also about Umar, he was the second Khalifa, and he was the first one. At the beginning, he was called the successor of the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Khalifatu Khalifatu Rasulullah. But then he was called Amir al-Mu'mineen, the commander of the believer, or the commander of the faithful, or the prince of the believer. This is the meaning. And then, because you know of his great job expanding Islam, the Magan people of the Persia, the Persian, at that time, who lose their state, their country, it was conquered by the Muslim. They were not happy with him. This is why one of them, called Abu Lu'lu'a al-Majusi, he came to Medina and he killed Umar radiallahu anh. Umar radiallahu anh asked Allah shahada, that he have shahada in Medina. And people, they were surprised, how come you can get shahada in Medina? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered his prayer, and he was assassinated in Medina while he was praying Salat al-Fajr. Here are the main word that I would like to mention when we explain the hadith. The word said innama, innama of two words, inna and ma. Innama, inna, this is a word of certain or confirmation. Inna للتأكيد, surely, certainly. Ma, only, for sure, only, and then whatever come after it. For sure, for example, only actions which was for the sake of Allah will be accepted. A'mal, this plural of amal, and amal is action. And as we said, the amal either amal al-qulub or amal al-jawarih. That means action of the heart or action of the limbs. And niyyah, niyat, plural of niyyah, which is the motive, the drive, whatever drive the person to act, called niyyah. Why? Because it's in the heart, hidden. This is why the Prophet ﷺ taught us that an-niyyah mahalluha al-qalb. The intention is in the heart. Therefore, it is not right to pronounce the niyyah, the intention, whenever we are doing any ibadah. We are not in need to say, oh Allah, I want to pray. Oh Allah, I want to make wudu. No. It's already known what I'm going to do based on what was my intention. Migration, hijrah. And migration in general mean abandon. Abandon. Like for example, abandon something. This is hijrah. That's when you leave it. Hajartuhu. Min al-hajr. Hajartuhu. That's mean I left. So this is why the hijrah in general meaning, it is to abandon anything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is haram. And specific meaning is moving from the land of the disbeliever to the land of the believer. And this was, some ulama, they said, this is end after, the conquer of Mecca. But some ulama, they said, wherever the Muslim, he cannot practice his deen in any community, it is recommended for him to immigrate and go to other place where he can practice his religion. Dunya means this world, this life, and meaning also which is very low compared to ulya. So worldly things, anything which relate to this world. And yankah, that's mean marry, yankah marry, and that's mean marry her. This is the main vocabularies of the hadith, and inshallah in the explanation of the hadith now you will see all the meaning of this word is included here. Now let's go to explaining the meaning of the hadith. Now this hadith, as we mentioned, very important for us because it still us and teach us to check and make sure about our intention, because all acts will not be accepted unless we make this a correct intention. This is why intention is one of the conditions of accepting all deeds. This is why, for example, when you talk about shurut al-salah, what is the condition of salah? Two. And some they said, I'm not talking about the correction of if it is correct. I mean to accepting the salah, or to accepting the zakah, or to accepting any deeds that we do, or any action, or any ibadah, any act of worship, it will not be accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal unless there was what? Two conditions. Meet two conditions. One, sincerity, that means this action done for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. Second, it should be in the example of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and in the light of the teaching of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is the two conditions that for any ibadah to be accepted. If the ibadah is, the intention is good, a person is doing something good, like giving money for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, but he bought this money in building bump over some graves, so the people, they come there to visit that grave and make certain ibadah. This is not right, not correct. A person, whatever he do, if it's not according to the way of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it will not be accepted. Because the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fahuwa rad." And Allah Azza wa Jal taught us about this when he said what? لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. The example in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. For anyone who seek the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal. So Umar radiallahu anhu said, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. And here, this is we talk about ikhlas. That means we should make sure that whatever we do it sincerely for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from this hadith, we learn that the action, good or bad, based on the intention. The actions accepted or not accepted, also based on the intention. So, niyyah, for any ibadah, we should make it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For any ibadah. And here, what's the purpose of niyyah here? First of all, to show to whom we are doing this. Is it for Allah? Then it will be sincere for Allah, this will be accepted. If it's not, or mixed, like a person who pray just to people look at him and say, MashaAllah, here's a nice prayer. This is riya. It's not for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, completely. The other thing which is related to the niyyah, to identify the action itself. What do we mean by this? Like, for example, now I'm praying two rak'ah. But is this two rak'ah, is it the sunnah, which is before fajr, or it is the two rak'ah of the fajr itself? Now, I didn't, for a person, for example, he didn't pray salat al-dhuhr. He was sleeping. And then he wake up at the time of Salat al-Asr. Now, there are two Salat. Salat al-Dhuhr or Salat al-Asr. And he want to do it at the same time. When he say Allahu Akbar, is this first Salah, is it for Dhuhr or Asr? The niyyah which will, you know, identify this Salah what for. So here we look at the niyyah, the intention from two sides. One, to whom? The second, in what is it about? Is it about Salat al-Dhuhr or Salat al-Asr? Is it about obligatory Salah or Nafila Salah? Is it about Sadaqa that we give or Zakah that we must to pay? So the niyyah is very important. This is why it is very important to care about it. Ibn Kathir said, تَعَلَّمُ النِّيَّةَ فَإِنَّهَا أَبْلَغُ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ. Learn how to correct your intention, because intention is more important than the action itself. Now, Also, the niyyah will turn the habit to an act of ibadah. The habit. For example, you used to visit your brother or your sisters or even your brothers in Islam. You go and visit them. This is habit. This is something like what you call it, you know, social communication or visiting with them. Social visitation. But if you put in your mind that today or tomorrow or any day that you want to visit your family, your sister, your uncle, recalling in your heart that you're doing this for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to be nice to your kinship, to your relatives, your visit, it will be an act of ibadah, an act of worship. This is why we need to correct our intention. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَاللُّقْمَ تَضَعُوَا فِي فَمِ زَوْجَتِكَ صَدَقَةً. Just imagine this. When you buy food for your family, every one of us think or believe, well, this is our responsibility. I have no choice. This is what I'm doing. So when you go and buy food to your family and bring it to them, some people, you know, this is the general understanding that this is our normal life. But if you recall the intention that you are doing this because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to spend in your wife, in your children, every real, every penny that you spend for feeding your family, it will be considered as sadaqah for you. Subhanallah. So we can collect a lot of good deeds just by correcting our intention. We can turn all our life, whatever we do, even you're sleeping, and you have rest before you sleep. If you sleep early, put it in your mind, I will sleep early to wake up for Salatul Fajr. Your intention that when you go to bed, that you sleep early for to be strong, when you know, and wake up early and do your Salatul Fajr, this intention for sleeping will be, your sleeping by itself is sadaqah on you, subhanallah. So this, my dear brothers, why it is very important to care about intention. Now, the Prophet ﷺ said, فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولُهُ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولُهُ. The one who intend to do anything for the sake of Allah, then it will be for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then he said, وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى دُنْيَا. Dunya open. Anything of this worldly life, anything. For position, for trading, collecting, or making farming, whatever. And then said, أو امرأة ينكحها. Or he just immigrated, or he cared about marrying a woman. And some ulama, they said, this was mentioned by one of the narration that it said, that this is one, explained this hadith, that there was at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, there was one man in Mecca who loved one woman called Umm Qais, Umm Qais. And Umm Qais became Muslim, she embraced Islam, and she moved to Medina. This man, because he wanted to marry her, he wanted to love her, so he asked her for marriage. She told him, I cannot marry you till you become Muslim and immigrate. So he embraced Islam and he immigrated to Medina. But his intention is what? To marry this woman. Unfortunately, this happened nowadays. You know, there are some people who may embrace Islam, you know, just for the purpose, because, especially men, because he knows that he cannot marry a Muslim woman without becoming Muslim. So he come and he said, I want to become a Muslim. And through many years past, I met some of these people, subhanallah. Some of them, alhamdulillah, after they learn the religion, they become, mashallah, good Muslim, righteous, maybe da'iyah. And some of them, they just took it for the interest of getting married. And subhanallah, this marriage did not succeed. So they leave, you know, their wife, and they leave also their religion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and keep us in the straight path. So this is important, the point that was mentioned in this hadith. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he didn't say it at the end, فهجرته إلى الدنيا وإلى المرأة التي تزوجها. Look, at the beginning he said فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله. But here he said فهجرته, his immigration to whatever he want. So he didn't mention why detail about this, because it's not important. That mean no matter what he gained in this world, it doesn't worth anything in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it's not for the sincerity, for the cause of Allah Azza wa Jal. Here, maybe we learn that about riya, what they call show off. You know, some people, they do something and they are concerned, well, is this for Allah or is this riya or something? Al-amal, as some ulama said, in a matter of riya, show off, it will be of three types. First one is the one who from the beginning he did this action not for the sake of Allah, from the beginning. Like munafiqin, hypocrite. Hypocrite, they pray, they don't believe in Allah, but they pray so they will not show for the Muslim that they are not believer. Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned about this when he said, وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالَى يُرَاؤُونَ النَّاسَ وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. When they go to prayer, they go, you know, with laziness. And they just show people that they are praying. This type of riya, because it is of the foundation of the action itself, that means it was the real motive of the action, this will not be accepted totally. Because this is nifaq. This is nifaq. Some, they may do prayers, or they may do the give sadaqah, and they want people to praise them. Now he is mixed. Yes, his initial intention is to please Allah by this sadaqah. But at the same time, he add in his niyyah that people also praise him, that he is a generous person. Allah will not accept this also. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as mentioned in the hadith Qudsi, أَنَا أَغْنَى الشُّرَكَاءَ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ. I am the one who is not in need for anybody to share something, you know, for me with me. So whoever make anything and he shares something else with me, I will leave it for him. The third one is a person who is doing prayer, but, you know, or giving sadaqah, and he's sincerely for Allah, but then people, they talk about this, mashallah, he's a generous person. He is good person. He do this, mashallah, his salah is. He didn't mint this, and he didn't look for it, but people say it, this will not affect his deed, because his intention was, from the beginning, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why, my dear brothers, subhanallah, the Muslim always should care about his heart, about his niyyah. And there is dua that we were, you know, taught to the Muslim, because we always afraid that what we are doing, and we don't like to get in the state of doubt always, and think, oh, did this for Allah or not? And the shaitan play this with me, you know. So there is dua. It said, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika shay'an a'lamu. وَأَسْتَغْفِرُكَ مِمَّا لَا أَعْلَمُ. This dua, the Muslim say it if he felt or he afraid that what was he doing, it's not sincerely for the sake of Allah. The action depends on the niyyah. Not only in the acceptance, but in the degree, in the level. The more the person is sincere for Allah Azza wa Jal, the more the reward will be greater. Sometimes, you know, the person will get the reward just for his niyyah. As and this mentioned in another hadith, a person, as it said, if one man said, if I have like so and so, that's mean a person, poor person, he noticed that one rich person, he gave a lot of money for sadaqat, helping poor, and he said, MashaAllah, may Allah bless him, I wish that I have the same money, then I will do this and this and this and this. And he was intentionally, that means he's eager to do this. He wished that he has wealth to do this, but he's poor. Allah Azza will give him the reward for his intention also. And this to show you the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. I think this more, inshallah, cover most of this, the meaning of this hadith. And therefore, we'll leave some time for the questions and comments. And inshallah, more detail, you'll receive it in the handout that we'll send it to you, because you know the time of the class is very short, only 1 hour. We take only 45 minutes and we leave the time for questions. But more detail, inshallah, you will receive it, inshallah, in the handout. Jazakum Allah khair, barakallah feekum. And if there are any questions, I'll be very happy to, inshallah, answer. Jazakum Allah khair. Yes, Sister Iman. There's no question.
Assalamu
alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We will deal first with the questions which we gathered from the previous lesson.
Okay.
And Sister Sarah, please can you just read them one by one to Dr. Yahya?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
We got these questions last lesson. Okay. The first question was, why is there a need for hadith when there's already the Quran?
Okay. Good. This is a good question. You know, unfortunately, my dear brothers and sisters, these days came group, they call themselves the Quranic group, Al-Quraniyun. And this is deviated group. And subhanAllah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned us, and this is subhanAllah of the prophecy of the Prophet that we see it ourselves these days, warned us about this. He said, alayhi salatu wasalam, the meaning of the hadith, I'm not going to read the hadith. It is very soon when a man sitting in his couch, that's mean he's relaxing, and hadith of me will reach him, and he will say, this man, he will say, between you and us, the book of Allah, the Quran, whatever the Quran will accept it. Any other thing else will not take it. That's mean he rejecting the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said what? أَلَا إِنِّي أُعْطِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. I was given the Quran and I give more like the Quran, which is mean revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why we need the sunnah? First of all, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we believe in the Quran itself encouraged us, in fact, commanded us to follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Allah Azza wa Jalla said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يَحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Say to them, O Prophet of Allah, if you truly love Allah, then follow me. Allah will love you. Follow me. طيب, how can we follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam if we don't know his way of life? How can we pray? The Prophet ﷺ taught the Sahaba the practical, you know, ibadat, like salah. He said, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray the same way that you saw me and pray. When he was in Hajj, he said, Khudu anni manasikakum. Learn from me what I'm doing about your Hajj, about the ritual. Subhanallah. Now the question is, in the Quran, do you find how many rak'ah, salat al-duhr, or salat al-maghrib, or any of the salah? It was not mentioned, the rak'ahat. When exact, how to call to the salah, al-adhan, al-iqama, what is the conditions for the salah? Many details, we cannot just, because the sunnah, the purpose of the sunnah, the Prophet ﷺ, to explain the Quran, and also to give us detail, and also to give us what? Example, practical example. Allah revealed the book, and he sent a teacher. What's the role of the teacher? To explain through his words, through his action, through his, the way that he act. Subhanallah, we learn the sunnah. So anyone who deny the sunnah and he said only the Quran, he disbelieve in the meaning of Muhammad Rasulullah. And in fact, he disbelieve in the Quran, because the Quran mentioned the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and commanded us to follow the sunnah. So we need the sunnah, because the sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained the many details of the deen that it was not mentioned, you know, in detail in the Quran. Now, other question.
Okay, Jazakallah khairan, well, doctor, for your excellent delivery of the lecture. May Allah elevate your status in Jannah. Amen.
Amen. You and everyone, question, inshallah. Now,
just want to ask you a question. One is the Hadithun Maudu. Same as Hadithun Maktu. Are they the same?
No, there's
another question.
Yeah, there's difference between Maktu' and Maudu'. The Maktu', we said, which reach the stage of the tabi, the successor of the sahaba. That means we have, you see, this is the level when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then come later the sahaba, and then after the sahaba come at tabi'in. And we said, if the hadith, you know, that the person who reported the hadith said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this hadith marfu' elevated because it was linked to the Prophet directly. If somebody of the Sahaba said, during our time we used to do this, you know, or we learned from the Prophet this, and he didn't link it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we call it, this is mawquf. And if the tabi'i, the successor, said anything or report something, but he didn't mention who is the Sahabi that he took this hadith from, and he said this, and it was supported, and this, you know, according to ilm al-jarh wal-ta'dil in the hadith, it was accepted, then we said this is maqtu'. So this hadith maqtu', it could be correct, it could be authentic, it could be da'if, it could be hasan, different. The mawdu' is different. Al-hadith al-mawdu' is a fabricated hadith. So here we are talking about this hadith does not meet the requirement or the criteria, you know, that the ulama put to accept this hadith. This is the difference between maqtu' and mawdu'. They are not the same. I hope this is clear, inshallah. Nah.
Okay, another one, continuation for that first question. As for lecture, we learned that hadithun, da'if, can be used for encouraging fa'idatun, amalin. Will it not be a later a cause of misguidance later for the ummah if one will continue narrating it and do it? Barakallahu fikum. Another question from our sister.
Tayyib, barakallahu fikum. No, because the ulama is already, alhamdulillah, the ulama of the hadith already, you know, classify all these, and some of them they already put them in a series of book, like Al-Imam Al-Albani rahimahullah, Al-Imam Nasruddin Al-Albani, he collected all the hadith da'if in one series. He called it silsilat al-ahadith al-da'if, silsilat al-ahadith al-sahiha. So he collected the sahih together and he put the da'if together. There is no harm, as we said, to benefit from this hadith da'if. But the sound view, which was followed by Imam al-Bukhari and some of the great ulama, that we are not in need for this hadith da'if. But as we know before, we said, the ulama, they were very careful when they accept this hadith da'if. They said, it is da'if. That means it could be, that's mean accepted. Why? Because it is supported by other hadith sahiha. Okay, this hadith, maybe this narration by itself, it's not correct. But the meaning which was mentioned there, it is correct by other ahadith. Like for example, as we mentioned the hadith, staying from after Fajr till sunrise, we said this is da'if. But if the person do this, there's no harm, because this not relate to the rules. When you talk about the rules, the ulama accept only al-hadith al-sahih. So there's no problem with this, because the ulama, alhamdulillah, they already collected all these type of hadith and classify it. The problem not with the hadith da'if, the problem with the fabricated hadith. These which are unfortunately now circulated, especially in the internet. And this is very important to be careful about, because many of the enemy of Islam, deviated group, Sufis, Shiism, all different groups, they try to send many and circulate many of these hadith, and some Muslim, because of good intention that he wants to circulate the hadith of the Prophet, he will send it and resend it and forward. This is what I said last time, that we should be very careful not to forward any hadith unless we are sure that it is at least authentic. Nah. Barakallah. Nah.
Okay, the third question is about the Arab philosopher, you know.
Yes.
Can be considered the saying of philosopher...
Wisdom, hikmah. Now, some people, they are confused about hikmah, because last time we said, you know, al-hikmah is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So just to elaborate something about this word. Al-hikmah, originally, from the language, it was took from the word al-hakama. Al-hakama is, you know, the iron or that was put in the mouth of the horse to control it. That means the guide or the rider of the horse to have control over the horse. They put this iron something in his mouth and hold it with rope. Why? So the horse will not jump, will not run, except under the control of the rider. From this, the Arab took the word hikmah, that means any thing that control the action of the person and his mind. And this is why the word of hikmah, it has different meaning. It means the wisdom in general. The wisdom in general. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Luqman, in Surah Luqman, Allah Azza wa Jal said about Luqman, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةِ. We gave Luqman al-hikmah, wisdom. So this is, that means the understanding, the logic, the rationality, when the good judgment for something. And the ulama said the hikmah is, like Shafi'i and others, they said al-hikmah, to do the right thing in the way that should be done, in the right time that should be done, in the way, or for the saying that you say the right word for the right person at the right place at the right time. This is hikmah. That means when you talk, even when you make da'wah, you need wisdom, you need hikmah. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Ud'u ila sabil rabbika," with what? "Ud'u ila sabil rabbika bil hikmah." When you call to Allah, call with what? With wisdom. What does this mean, wisdom? That means knowledge. That means the nice approach. You know, the right approach. Like for example, if you are talking, inviting Hindu, it's not the way that when you are inviting a people of the book, like a Christian. It's not wise when you talk to the Hindu, you will tell him, in the Bible mention this and this and this. And he's not aware of the Bible. But this, when you talk to a Christian who is, you know, aware of his book, that we said, okay, you are talk with him, something that he understand. So this is the meaning, the hikmah in general. In the Quran, it has two meanings, but more than meaning. The Quran, in the Quran, if it was come alone, that means the word, the hikmah alone, it means prophethood. Like for example, Allah Azza wa Jalla said about Dawood alayhi salam, وَقَتَلَ دَوُودُ جَالُوتُ وَأَتَى اللَّهُ الْكِتَابُ الْمُلْكَ وَالْحِكْمَةُ. Allah gave him power to be a king, وَالْحِكْمَةُ, that's mean prophethood. So Hikmah here means, or wisdom means what? Prophethood. But whenever the word, two words come together, Al-Kitab wal-Hikmah, that's mean refer to the book, the Quran, and to the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the most valuable and high, you know, types of Hikmah, wisdom. So this is why we call it Al-Hikmah. Now, let's come to the question here. So, is it, can we take and we say this about words that's come by Al-Ghazali or Al-Kindi, or even about some of the non-Muslim word of Hikmah? Yes, why not? Why not? If it is logic, if it is rational, this is why sometimes we learn some words from different cultures would have good meaning. Good and deep meaning. Even it's from non-Muslim. This is why it said, Al-Hikmah Dallatu Al-Mu'min. Al-Hikmah. Knowledge. You know, insight. Good understanding. This is what the Muslim is looking for. So we may learn even from non-Muslim. If they, you know, there is a statement which has, deep meaning. As long as it's not contradict with what? With our belief and the teaching of Islam. So this is general meaning of the hikmah. But here, specifically, it called the hikmah of what? The sunnah called the hikmah when it's mentioned in the Quran. Like Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَبْعَثِهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلِيمْ آيَاتِكْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Teach them the book and the hikmah, which is the knowledge of the deen, which is the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned this also in Surah Al-Jum'ah. بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياتي. Recite the ayat of Allah. ويعلمهم الكتاب and teach the book. والحكمة, which is the sunnah. نعم. وعليكم السلام.
It's already 12. Do we still have time for the questions?
Or if there's a question, no problem. You can say it. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. There is one question here. Our niyat is being in our hearts. Yes. So, what about the when it is being mentioned during the Hajj? I mean, before Hajj and Umrah. I think this is regards the ritual recitation of the. Yeah,
Labaikala, Umrah, or Labaikala. Yes, this is a good question also, because many people they ask and many confused about this. You see, my dear brothers and sisters, we said the intention is in the heart. So the person who wants to make Umrah, when does this start? When it's come to his mind and his heart, he said, without speaking, that he wants to make Umrah, intention to make Umrah. This started where? Started in his mind, in his heart. Now, when he come, now he make wudu, okay, and he wear the clothes of ihram, and he said, Labbayka Umrah. This is not the intention. The saying, the statement saying, Labbayka Umrah, is not the intention. Because the intention started before he started this ritual. And this is why some ulama, they said, this is just naming the action or naming, or the action that he will do of ibadah. Like Sheikh bin Uthaymeen said, this is like when we say takbiratul ihram. For example, when we pray, when we say Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, this must mean this is starting, now I'm starting what? My prayer. The same thing when he said Labbayka Umrah, it's like takbiratul ihram. Like he's saying, I'm starting my ritual now this. So there's difference between this and this. So this is not niyyah and not considered as niyyah. The intention, when this will be, problem, if the person before he start, when it's come to him, he said, oh Allah, I want, to perform Umrah. And then he started to make, ihram and he take, prepare for this. This is, he announced his niyyah. But after he was ready to start the ritual, this is like takbirat al-haram. This is just you know, naming that ritual that we start. Because you need to identify what type of ritual he will do. Is it Umrah? Is it Umrah, Hajj, Tamattu, or Quran, and so on.
There's another question here like now. Is there any signs to show that we are sincere in our intentions when we begin every work with intending to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Well, you see, as we said before, the intention is not an easy matter, by the way. It's not an easy matter. We should struggle for this. We should struggle for this. You know, some ulama, they said, I've been struggling with the intention of my heart for 40 years. But we should not make it very difficult for ourselves. And also, we should not get into the circle of doubt from the shaitan that always, you know, the shaitan will play on you. Ah, you are not doing this for Allah. You are doing this for this. We should not look or listen for this whispering. You know, you try your best, you know, that you make this niyyah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do your job. As we said, if the person he was doing something which is good and people announce, for example, the person he's giving money, as we said, and people they say, oh, he's generous. He was not looking for what they are saying. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked about this. They said, oh, Prophet of Allah, sometimes we do something and people praise us for what we did, which is for we did it for the sake of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't worry about this. Don't pay any attention for this. This is glad tidings. This is good news for the believer. This is good sign for you. So, my dear brothers and sisters, we should correct our intention for the sake of Allah. And then we pray always that he make our intention for him. And we remember this hadith, inshallah, I will send it in the handout, the dua to protect our niyyah. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika shay'an a'lam. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you that I do anything which associates somebody beside you, which is shirk, niyyah. Wa astaghfiruka mimma la a'lamu. And oh Allah, forgive me if I did something and I didn't mean it. Because you see, we have no control in our heart. The heart is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal. But we do our best. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it very easy for us. La yukallif Allahu nafsan illa wasa'ah. Allah Azza wa Jal will not put burden on us more than what we can handle. Nah.
Is it considered, in fact, when a person feels laziness to perform the salah, but the person prays because he is scared of Allah's punishment?
If he's scared from Allah, that's mean he's believing in Allah. So this is not nifaq. But he need to work hard for him. And this, you see, the nifaq of two types. The nifaq, the hypocrisy of two types. Nifaq on i'tiqadi, wa nifaq on amali. So the person who is lazy for the salah, he's in his heart, believe in Allah and believe that he should do it. This is, he doesn't like the munafiqeen who have in their faith, in their belief. But his action, the way that he do it, he resembling those hypocrites who are lazy from salah. Therefore, he should work hard on himself, not to be, you know, following their example. And this is why he should take good care of his salah. Now,
there's one question here which is not related to the topic. Is it okay?
No problem. Okay.
It's about the dua. When we do the dua, when is the right time to do this during the salah? Is it before ending the salah or after saying the tasmeen?
Well, there is some narrations which said that after you finish التحيات والصلاة على النبي, you make dua before you say salam. This is before say salam, this is the time for making dua. Because the ulama said, dua before the salam and adhkar after the salam. Dua making dua, like for, because the Prophet ﷺ taught us this, that before you, one say salam or conclude the salah, he should ask Allah Jalla refuge of the four, and you know this, اللهم إني أعوذ بك من عذاب جهنم وعذاب القبر ومن فتنة المحيا والممات ومن فتنة المسيح الدجال. That we seek Allah refuge from these four things, from the Satan, from the fire, from the grave, from the fitna of this world. This, the Prophet ﷺ said that after we finish, before we conclude our salah. Now, what's come after salah? We taught, you know, that to say different words of remembering, like saying Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, saying La ilaha illallah, saying Astaghfirullah. So the adhkar after the salam, the dua before the salam. Now, this is why, like, for example, before the salam, he said, Allahumma anni ala dhikrika wa shukrik wa husn ibadatik. Now.
Okay, yes,
wa iyyakum.
Those are the questions we have gathered.
Alhamdulillah. Is there, maybe ask the other brothers who are, you know, sisters who are, maybe if anybody has a question, he want to say it himself, or he want to write it. Any of the audience, you have any question, or we should conclude and say, yeah. You know.
Those last three questions were from the audience.
طيب, Jazakumallah khair. Barakallah feekum. So inshallah we'll send prepare the handout for this lesson. It will be more detail about this, inshallah, more explanation, more points, inshallah. And this is why I encourage brothers and sisters who are following us on the Facebook that they join the Zoom, because they can benefit. It's better for them to register with GDC so they can receive the handout of this class. جزاكم الله خيرا. بارك الله فيكم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Recording stopped.
طيب.